Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Joy of Agility, How to Solve Problems and Succeed Sooner, by Joshua Kerievsky, narrated by Joshua Kerievsky. For Bruce, Diana, Dimitri, Sasha, Sophia, and Eva, and most of all, Maria. Preface. One of the greatest gifts of my life has been discovering how agility enables excellence. I love finding ways to make slow and awkward things faster and easier, solving difficult problems by being readily resourceful, and adapting to change with speed and grace. It's the joy of agility. In the late 1990s, I was part of a small movement that pioneered what would become agile software development. We experimented with ways to remove anything that slowed us down or made work difficult. My interactions with colleagues became smoother, collaboration with customers became closer, feedback came faster, making changes became safer, and handling unexpected events became easier. We learned how to sustainably create more value with less waste. That ultimately helped us produce happier customers sooner. Several decades spent experimenting, learning, unlearning, and reflecting on the nature of agility, including helping my own company and our clients become more agile, applying agility to home repairs, health, fitness, parenting, and more, led to this book. Joy of Agility begins by tackling the widespread confusion surrounding the definition of the word agile. It then presents 6 agile mantras that help make agility actionable. Finally, the majority of the book is an anthology of stories. These stories serve to clarify one or more agile mantras and come from many professions, including business, education, entertainment, sports, psychology, marketing, aviation, and more. Every story concludes with a call to action. I will be delighted if even one of these stories inspires you to put this book down and take action. Introduction. Taking action. One morning in 2002, more than 5 years after starting my own company, I read a book that revealed a huge mistake I was making. The book, Selling the Invisible, A Field Guide to Modern Marketing by Harry Beckwith, is a collection of insightful stories, each of which concludes with a call to action. That morning, 2 of the stories I read had such an impact on me that I immediately changed how I was marketing my company. The first story, called Fanatical Focus, explained the importance of not trying to be all things to all people. Instead of focusing on quality, price, and value, the pizza company Domino's relentlessly stressed its speed, 30 minutes or it's on us. That story concluded with the call to action. Stand for one distinctive thing that will give you a competitive advantage. The second story, called The Fear of Positioning, amplified the first story so intensely that I had to put the book down to think about how I could apply what I had just learned to my own business. It explained how most companies are afraid to stand for one thing, since that means not standing for a bunch of other important things. In this story, the author explains how Scandinavian Airlines, SAS, was struggling badly in 1980. Faced with a $20 million loss, the airline decided to reposition itself as the Business Travelers Airline. Despite major concerns that they would lose the business of its bread-and-butter tourist travelers, SAS forged ahead with the idea, offering a new service called Euroclass. Business travelers could now get olives and martinis, bigger seats, phones, telexes, a separate 4-minute faster check-in counter, and free drinks, newspapers, and magazines. SAS made $80 million the first year it offered Euroclass. And what about the tourist passengers, seemingly abandoned by this new position? They were happier than ever. Given all of the sales of expensive business class seats, SAS could afford to offer bargain basement prices for economy seats, which tourists snapped up. Flights were full, and standing for one thing was the secret behind SAS's success. The call to action at the end of this story was simple and direct. To broaden your appeal, narrow your position. After reading that story, I considered my own company's position. The homepage of our website offered 5 different software development services. We were most definitely not standing for one thing. At the time, design patterns was our cash cow, but Extreme Programming, XP, was a bigger and more important service, I decided right there and then to reposition my company as the XP company and immediately changed our website to make the new position clear. In the months and years that followed, Industrial Logic became known around the globe as the source for the world's best XP training and coaching. Revenue climbed, the company grew, and we even continued to have plenty of design patterns business. All of that happened because I'd read a couple of Harry Beckwith's brilliant stories. The stories and joy of agility are meant to inspire you to take action. As you read each one, ask yourself how you would apply the lesson to your context. Joy of Agility is also a springboard to other books. Throughout my career, I've learned a great deal from brilliant authors. You'll find references to their books scattered throughout the chapters that follow. Each one is an invitation to further explore aspects of agility. The Agile Birth of a Shoe Company. When Kenneth Cole founded his footwear company in 1982, the odds were stacked against him. His funds were limited, and the U.S. economy was in recession. To manufacture his shoes, he needed money, but obtaining a bank loan during a tough economic period would be difficult. To market and sell his shoes later that year, he would need footwear buyers and sellers to see his products at the New York Shoe Expo, which took place at the Hilton Hotel in Midtown Manhattan. However, unlike established shoe companies, he couldn't afford the expensive showcase rooms at the Hilton. Like Kenneth Cole, we all face challenges. Regardless of our profession, we struggle to find our way through tough conditions, unexpected events disrupt us, new obstacles impede our progress, and the status quo keeps pulling us back. Organizations typically struggle with too much bureaucracy, insufficient innovation, poor collaboration, serious quality problems, disempowered and unmotivated staff, and ever-increasing pressure to deal with nimble competitors. What could help us overcome such challenges? Being agile. Agility helps us solve problems with quick, easy grace. As you'll learn later in this book, it helped American Airlines rapidly respond to a travel mandate during the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic. It helped Oprah Winfrey successfully defend herself from a lawsuit while continuing to air her hit show. It helped Paul O'Neill rescue a 100-year-old industrial giant. It helped my own company pivot successfully to retain our business with Google during a global recession. And it helped Paul McCrady's team invent the world's first human-powered airplane. It also helped Kenneth Cole overcome the challenges he faced when starting his shoe company. His first decision was to avoid the delays and difficulties of seeking a bank loan to fund his line of elegant women's shoes. Instead, he flew to Italy and found Italian shoemakers who needed his business and would manufacture his shoes on credit. Returning to New York with thousands of pairs of shoes, he had to find an affordable and effective way to showcase his products at the New York Shoe Expo. On a whim, he called a friend in the trucking business to see if he could park a 40-foot trailer across the street from the Hilton. His friend was happy to lend him the trailer, but said that parking it in Midtown Manhattan for several days would be impossible. Undeterred, Kenneth Cole called the mayor's office to learn about the city's parking rules. He discovered that only utility or motion picture production companies could park large vehicles on Manhattan streets for extended periods of time. That afternoon, Kenneth bought stationery and business cards with a new company name, Kenneth Cole Productions, Inc. The following morning, he filed for a permit to shoot a feature-length film called The Birth of a Shoe Company. It was quickly approved. Kenneth then decorated the trailer, hired actresses to model the shoes, and brought on a director. When the New York Shoe Expo began, hundreds of curious shoe buyers lined up to explore what was inside the trailer, while the director filmed the action. Within 2.5 days, Kenneth Cole sold 40,000 pairs of shoes. Being agile helped Kenneth Cole succeed. When he launched his shoe company, his business dealings were quick, he adapted to tough economic conditions with ease, he was resourceful in finding a unique and inexpensive way to stand out from the crowd, and he was graceful in the creative way he sold thousands of pairs of shoes. Kenneth Cole's story, and others like it in this book, is meant to help you understand what is required to be agile. Before we dive into those stories, let's first review what the word agile means. The definition of agile. Agile is an adjective that further defines a noun. For example, an agile dancer, driver, pilot, nurse, programmer, executive, manager, team, or department. The Merriam-Webster Dictionary defines agile as marked by ready ability to move with quick, easy grace, or having a quick, resourceful, and adaptable character. Both of these definitions are useful for understanding how to be agile in your context. Being agile involves, yet isn't exclusively about, speed, hence the word quick in both of Merriam-Webster's definitions. Being quick does not mean hurrying, rushing, or otherwise moving so fast that you are out of control. And let me repeat, being quick does not mean being agile. It also requires ease and grace or being adaptable and resourceful. Saying someone is quick and agile is redundant, since being agile requires being quick. And finally, we often need to slow down in order to learn how to be genuinely quick. Being agile involves ease. When you witness agility, it often looks effortless. Ease in movement or bearing often results from great skill and practice. Agility also requires grace, which in this context means ease and suppleness of movement or bearing. Suppleness associates grace with adaptability, since the word means readily adaptable or responsive to new situations. When we are graceful, we interact harmoniously with others, we move with ease, we are balanced, relaxed, and able to respond to new situations without hesitation. Putting all of that together, being agile requires movement or behavior that is at once quick, effortless, balanced, and harmonious. It isn't easy. When we are agile, we are readily resourceful, able to quickly, creatively, and skillfully handle difficulties or new situations. Being agile also involves being adaptable, capable of adjusting to new conditions or uses. Adaptability isn't synonymous with agility. If it takes you a long time to adapt to something, you aren't agile. Agility requires being quickly and easily adaptable. Putting all of that together, being agile requires being quick and clever in overcoming or adapting to new or unexpected situations. Fear stifles agility. When we are afraid of being injured, blamed, penalized, or dismissed, we become hesitant, defensive, or even paralyzed, and our ability to be quick, graceful, adaptable, and resourceful is diminished. Becoming agile requires ongoing practice. It's a journey, not something you learn quickly in a book, article, or class. No one becomes agile merely by acquiring a certification in someone else's idea of an agile process. Just as it takes dedication and practice to gain skill in a musical instrument, writing, cooking, or a sport, you will also need to study and practice agility in order to gain skill in it. Agile mantras, the subject of the next section, provide a way to deliberately practice agility. 6 Agile Mantras. A mantra is something you contemplate regularly and that continuously guides your decisions and actions. The 6 Agile mantras in this book stand on the shoulders of giants in fields as diverse as quality management, athletic coaching, resilience engineering, psychological safety, and business leadership. These mantras exist to help individuals, groups, teams, departments, divisions, and whole organizations develop agility. The 6 Agile mantras also form the major parts of this book. In each part, you'll find a description of the mantra along with numerous stories that further explain it. For now, let's look at brief summaries of each of the 6 mantras. Be quick, but don't hurry. Succeed sooner via quickness under control and avoid costly mistakes from hurrying or rushing. Be balanced and graceful. Resolve imbalances, collaborate harmoniously with others, and make change empowering, not forced. Be poised to adapt. develop a readiness to revise or respond quickly and easily to change. Start minimal and evolve. Begin quickly and easily with something basic and rapidly improve it based on what you learn. Drive out fear. Make safety a prerequisite to protect people and pave the way for high performance. Be readily resourceful. Solve problems without hesitation by being quick, clever, and creative. The bulk of this book is devoted to helping you understand each of the six Agile mantras via stories. Each story explores the nuances of a mantra so you can more deeply understand what it means. Since all six of the Agile mantras are closely related, you'll often find two or more Agile mantras present in any given story. Before we explore each Agile mantra, I first want to share a few stories that exemplify agility and illustrate the power of simultaneously applying many Agile mantras at once. Break on through to the Agile side. The stories here are some of my favorites for explaining what it means to be Agile. Each describes a breakthrough resulting in a joyful outcome to a challenge. As you read each story, notice the decisions and behavior of the people, teams, or organizations. Then ask yourself which of the six Agile mantras are present. Doing this will help you get better acquainted with agility and the six Agile mantras before we unpack each mantra in more depth. You can still dunk in the dark. On February 3, 2013, a couple of minutes into the third quarter of the Super Bowl, the Superdome in New Orleans was suddenly plunged into almost complete darkness. It was an astonishing moment during America's biggest sporting and advertising event of the year. With the entire stadium in near complete darkness, the championship game between the Baltimore Ravens and San Francisco 49ers came to an abrupt halt. What happened? Was it a terrorist attack? A post-Hurricane Katrina breakdown in critical infrastructure? No one knew during the first few eerie minutes. Gradually, it became clear that a partial power outage had occurred. It took 22 minutes to restore power, and play resumed 34 minutes after it had been halted. During the blackout, a beautiful example of team agility occurred. But the team I'm talking about wasn't on the football field. It was in an office, 1,300 miles away. Soon after the stadium went dark, a 13-person group working for Oreo, America's best-selling cookie, seized the moment to compose and publish a tweet. The tweet featured a picture of an Oreo cookie and the words, "Power out? No problem. You can still dunk in the dark." The tweet went viral. Oreo's follower count on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram grew exponentially. Accolades poured in via social media and email. The following day, the advertising industry declared Oreo the winner of the Super Bowl. One media outlet announced that the best ad of the Super Bowl wasn't an ad. It was a tweet. Oreo wanted to remind everyone that it was America's favorite cookie, and its agile branding and marketing team had succeeded wildly in achieving that goal. How was this epic tweet created? You might think that a few self-organizing Oreo creatives suddenly saw an opportunity, hurried to capitalize on it, and rushed out the tweet. Yes, the Oreo advertising team saw an opportunity and acted on it, but that isn't the full story of the famous blackout tweet. The story was actually years in the making. Oreo turned 100 years old in 2012. To celebrate its birthday, the company wanted to show just how deeply ingrained the Oreo cookie was in American culture. For 100 consecutive days, Oreo posted social media content associating the cookie with anything noteworthy in the news, such as the Mars rover landing, Elvis Week, and the anniversary of the creation of the rainbow gay pride flag. Called the Daily Twist, members of Oreo's brand team and a few advertising agencies collaborated daily in a room in New York City. Working closely together in one room enabled the team to respond quickly and creatively to interesting cultural events. By the time the Super Bowl took place in 2013, the Daily Twist had helped the team develop muscle memory for real-time branding and marketing. Michael Nuzzo, creative director for the advertising agency 360i, recalled, "We had these daily content calendars across social platforms, and every day we would review the content calendar. We'd been very thoughtful, planned in advance what we would do. Short of a meteor falling out of the sky, we knew." 10 people from the team were in the war room on Super Bowl Sunday, including Michael Nuzzo, Maggie Walsh, 360i's strategist, copy editors, graphic designers, and Oreo brand representatives. Lisa Mann, VP of Cookies for Kraft Foods, owner of Oreo at the time, and Sarah Hofstetter, 360i's CEO, watched the game from home and were connected to the team via their laptops and phones. The day before the Super Bowl, the team had met in the war room to test the technology and rehearse how they would perform on the big day. "We were overprepared," said Walsh. "We had this dry run on Saturday, and we had this worksheet. So what happens if this person does this? This person does this? Who writes the copy? Who presses send?" We had all the tracking in place. Soon after the blackout began, Michael Nuzzo said to everyone in the war room, "We should probably do something." Seconds later, Sarah Hofstetter sent an email to the team with the subject, "Power? Opt to capitalize?" The team replied that they were already on it. Nuzzo threw out the line, "You can dunk in a blackout." And in under a minute, the team had the Twitter post composed. The post needed approval from Oreo, and fortunately, a high-speed approval process was already in place. Oreo's associate brand manager, Danielle Brown, also in the war room, quickly made sure that no terrorist event had occurred and that it was safe to post. Next, she emailed Lisa Mann for final approval, writing, "I really wanted to say, you can still dunk in the dark." Lisa loved it and quickly gave final approval. The post was updated and published. From start to finish, the team had taken only a few minutes to design, caption, approve, and publish their epic tweet. So, while the Oreo creative saw an opportunity, worked fast to capitalize on it, and quickly pushed out the tweet, providing the world with a marketing case study in what agility is all about, Lisa Mann would say that it really took 2 years to publish that tweet. It involved conceiving of Oreo's branding and marketing strategy to commemorate its 100th birthday, forming the Daily Twist team to produce content for 100 consecutive days, gaining skill in associating the cookie with daily newsworthy events, and ultimately, growing a team that could reliably perform high-quality, real-time branding and marketing. The epic tweet didn't involve hurrying and wasn't a spontaneous act of genius. It was the result of the right mix of people, a balanced team, learning how to collaborate gracefully and make decisions rapidly in order to be poised to adapt to real-time events. Without such work, the team would not have been able to be so readily resourceful in a profoundly unexpected situation like a Super Bowl blackout. Agility requires practice and preparation. Chris Rock's Little Bets. I love seeing great comedians perform. The truly great ones make me cry with laughter and keep me laughing throughout their set with their insights, timing, intonation, expressions, and body language. Have you ever wondered how such performances become so funny? In his book, Little Bets, How Breakthrough Ideas Emerge from Small Discoveries, Peter Sims reveals what star comedians like Chris Rock do to create comedy gold. Sims calls it a rigorous experimental discovery process. Chris Rock routinely shows up unannounced at a comedy club in New Brunswick, New Jersey, about an hour's drive from his home. The audience of 50 or so people is thrilled to have this star comedian perform for them. But after Chris Rock takes the stage, the audience soon discovers that Rock isn't his normal, funny, animated self. Sims explains that when Chris Rock tests out new material, he doesn't launch into his familiar performance mode that fans describe as the full preacher effect, when he uses animated body language, pitchy and sassy vocal intonations, and erupting facial expressions. Instead, Rock sits calmly on a bar stool with a legal pad filled with ideas and casually tests out each idea while observing his audience intently, noticing heads nodding, shifting body language, or attentive pauses, all clues to where good ideas might reside. Developing a great new comedy set requires operating under what Eric Ries, author of The Lean Startup, calls conditions of uncertainty. To learn what is or isn't funny, Chris Rock starts in the safety of a small, intimate venue where he can protect his brand and experiment without fear. To discover and develop the few gems that will make audiences erupt with laughter, he takes little bets, quickly testing hundreds of raw or uneven pieces of content. Eventually, he experiments in slightly larger venues with bigger audiences. Night after night, for weeks or months, he removes uncertainty, always being poised to adapt his comedy set until it is consistently funny and ready for the biggest stages. Under conditions of uncertainty, take little bets. Apply a rigorous experimental discovery process. Let there be water balloons. A few days before she turned 7, my daughter Eva asked if she could have a water balloon fight during her birthday party. Sure, I immediately replied, but the thought of making more than a few water balloons filled me with dread. I knew this meant hours of awkward fiddling. First, pick out an empty balloon, fill it with water, hope it didn't pop prematurely, and then use my not-so-nimble fingers to tie the slippery, wet end into a tiny knot. Over and over again. Josh Malone, a father of 8 kids, understood the pain of producing water balloons in large numbers. During hot summers in Texas, his family loved to have water balloon fights, but disliked the slow, hard work of making many water balloons. This problem inspired Malone to invent a brilliant, award-winning product called Bunch-O-Balloons to make the process quick, easy, and graceful. While I was out buying supplies for Eva's party, I was intrigued when I saw a bunch of balloons at a local store. The words on the package read, "Fill and tie 100 water balloons in 60 seconds with our sensational self-tying water balloons. Say goodbye to the stress and mess of filling individual water balloons, and say hello to never-ending splash-out-loud fun." I was sold. I bought a bunch of balloons for Eva's party, and I look forward to learning if the product could live up to its promise. On the day of the event, I attached the stem feeding the first set of water balloons to an outdoor faucet and turned on the water. In just seconds, I made more than 30 water balloons. As I pulled each perfect yellow balloon from its attached rod, a self-tying rubber O-ring contracted into place, sealing the water inside each balloon. It was so quick and easy. I performed the same procedure for the red and blue balloons in the package, and in no time had filled an entire bucket with 100 water balloons. Just like the advertisement said, there was no stress or mess. Eva was thrilled. I was thrilled. And during the party, the kids were thrilled as they engaged in a fun water balloon fight. Bunch-O-Balloons made me an excellent dad, made Eva an excellent party host, and helped her friends have a wonderful time. Of course, making water balloons in large quantities is a relatively trivial thing. Bunch-O-Balloons hasn't exactly changed the world with its product. Yet, this innovative product can serve as an inspiration to anyone in any organization. What activities are you or your customers forced to perform today that are slow, hard, and ungraceful? What product or service could you invent that would give you or your customers the superpowers to make those same activities quick, easy, and graceful? Help people be agile by removing the stress and mess of slow, hard, ungraceful experiences. Banking on joy. One morning at Westpac Bank in Wellington, New Zealand, a team of software developers paid a visit to the tellers who worked in their local bank branch. This was the developer's first time meeting their actual users. The visit had been arranged by Hamish King, a lean, agile coach who'd recently joined the team. He knew how important it was for developers to get to know their customers, and he decided to do something about it. One of the developers on the team had been building software for the bank tellers for 10 years. He had always worked from requirements documents, but had never once met with a real-life, flesh-and-blood teller. Before the local bank branch opened, the tellers met with the developers to discuss problems they experienced with the software and ideas they had for improvements. Once the bank opened, the developers watched the bank tellers at work. One customer walked up to a teller with a slip of paper that indicated she wanted to deposit cash into her vacation savings account. The bank teller said he didn't know what the customer's vacation savings account was. There was no such thing in his system. The transaction would require an account number. "Why?" asked the customer. "The Westpac website allows me to nickname my accounts, and I named one of them Vacation Savings. That's where I want the money to go." The bank teller explained that he didn't have access to account nicknames. "Sorry," he said. "I'll need your account number to proceed." The customer, looking visibly annoyed, managed to find the account number and completed the transaction. When the bank closed for the day, the developers and bank tellers met again to produce a set of post-it notes that they could stick on the wall, each one describing a proposed improvement. To prioritize this work, they roughly quantified the value of each improvement by looking at time saved per customer interaction, improved customer experience, reduction of errors, amount of work required to make the improvement, and so on. After assigning values to each post-it, fixing the issue with bank tellers not being able to see nicknamed accounts rose to the top of the list. A few days later, the developers returned with some paper prototypes that illustrated design choices for displaying nicknamed accounts on the teller's already busy screens. The tellers discussed pros and cons of each design with the developers and then selected their favorite. 2 weeks later, the developers returned to demonstrate the new design that was now in production and ready for the bank tellers to use. Said Hamish King, "The joy on the faces of the bank tellers and developers was amazing to see because it was theirs. Collectively, that group had worked it all the way through from ideation to production. The collaboration between the developers and the staff of that local bank branch continued as they took on problems and worked out improvements. Over time, the entire staff of the local bank branch adopted more agile practices, such as agile planning, retrospectives on bank operations, and voting for improvements. All of this led to better service to Westpac customers and happier bank staff. How often do you or your team spend with actual users or customers? What could improve this collaboration? Bring together people who can identify and solve problems. Close, frequent collaboration increases agility. Eva learns to ride. When my youngest daughter, Eva, was ready to learn to ride a bicycle, I started seeing young kids at the park riding balance bikes, small, low-to-the-ground bicycles without pedals. The kids would ride these bikes by pushing off with their feet, lifting their legs up to glide, and putting their feet on the ground to stop. Even though I learned to ride with training wheels, and Eva's two older sisters also learned that way, I wondered if Eva could learn more rapidly using this balance bike technique. We already had a small bike that could function as a balance bike. I adjusted the seat to the lowest position so Eva's feet could easily touch the ground. Since I lacked the tools to remove the pedals, I figured Eva could just ignore them. With the bike ready to go, Eva grabbed a helmet and we headed for the park. The park featured a perfect patch of flat concrete as well as a long, gently sloping concrete hill. On the flat patch of concrete, I instructed Eva to sit down on the bike, push off with her feet, and then lift up her legs to glide along. She tried and immediately fell off. She was uninjured, since she'd moved only about 2 feet and was initially positioned quite low to the ground. She got back up to try again, this time without any issues. After several minutes of practicing on the flat concrete, we moved to the gently sloping hill. Eva glided slowly down the hill, stopping herself about every 10 feet, then pushing off again. Within half an hour, she was gliding all the way down the hill without stopping until she reached the end. At this point, another dad and his daughter showed up at the park. The daughter's bike had training wheels, but the dad had just finished adjusting them to be higher so they didn't touch the ground. I gathered that his daughter had been riding her bike with training wheels for some time now and was at that critical juncture of learning to balance without getting as much help from them. She pedaled slowly and carefully, still relying on help from the training wheels for balance. By now, Eva decided it was time to play on the swings and monkey bars. While she played, I watched the dad completely remove the training wheels from his daughter's bike so she could progress to the next step in her education. The girl was initially afraid to ride alone, nervous that she would fall over, so her dad walked slowly beside her, holding onto the bike. Soon, Eva hopped back on her bike and started gliding down the hill. As the dad and daughter moved slowly down the hill, Eva easily glided past them. Several minutes later, Eva was ready to try pedaling. She'd get one foot on a pedal, push off, and make it a few feet before putting both of her feet down again. The more she tried this, the closer she came to getting it. Then Eva announced she was ready to head home. We'd been at the park for a little over 2 hours. Before we left, I asked the dad if he had any interest in having his daughter try gliding with our bike. His daughter was not making much progress with the training wheels removed. "No thanks," he replied. The next morning, Eva and I returned to the park. On the flat patch of concrete at the entrance to the park, Eva sat down on her bike, pushed off, and began pedaling. She was riding. When she pedaled back toward me and stopped, she flashed a triumphant smile. Eva had similar success on the gentle hill. We found some orange cones, and she rode her bike in circles around them. I explained how braking worked, and she practiced that as she pedaled down the slope. I was amazed that after only 2 short trips to the park, consisting of no more than 3 hours in total, Eva was biking gracefully. This experience was starkly different and far better than how my older daughters and I learned to ride. Training wheels had made it easy for us to pedal around, but they failed to teach us balance, the essence of biking. We all experienced a great deal of fear as we attempted to ride without training wheels. In comparison, the balance bike approach helped Eva safely and efficiently learn to balance right from the start. Once she mastered balance, it was easy and graceful for her to transition to pedaling. While more and more parents today are using the balance bike technique to help their kids learn to ride, training wheels are still as popular as ever. When I see a child learning to ride with training wheels, I feel like telling the adult next to them to stop using such an outdated and inferior approach. Since these people are complete strangers to me, I don't utter a word, but it's hard to watch. Traditions are hard to break. Many people who learned how to perform a skill years or decades ago use the same technique when teaching others. They are stuck in a traditional mindset, unaware of new, innovative approaches that help us establish balance sooner, drive out fear more effectively, and make it quicker, easier, and more graceful to learn a new skill. Don't just blindly follow long-established approaches when learning a new skill. Explore alternatives that accelerate learning. Consider your options. After years of working without fail, my bathtub was no longer able to fill up with water. A mere trickle flowed from the faucet, and it was time to call a plumber. The first plumber I called inspected all of the faucets in my 80-year-old home and said, "You need new pipes throughout this old house and all the way down to the street. I've been in this business for 3 decades, and I can tell you that no other solution will solve the problem. I asked how much it would cost. Around $9,000, he said. I called a second plumber, and after looking over my pipes, he had better news. You only need a new pipe from the downstairs water heater to the upstairs bathroom, he told me. I can do that work, but it will involve breaking down part of the bathroom wall and tearing up your outside deck. I don't put decks back together. You'll have to handle that on your own, but I can get the new pipe installed for $3,000. Well, that was much cheaper than the $9,000 the first plumber quoted me, but it still sounded expensive and awkward, especially the deck part. I wanted to find out if there were any other options, so I called yet another plumber. This third plumber was different from the rest. He specialized in repairs to old homes and had developed an amazing solution for clogged pipes. He used a focused jet of CO2 gas to remove blockages in old pipes and restore flow. The price to do all this? $125. I immediately wrote a check. He performed the service, and full water flow was restored to my bathtub. The problem did not resurface even years later. I had nearly chosen the $3,000 solution, which would have been a hasty decision. I knew it wouldn't take much time or effort to explore more options, and so I did. I was lucky to find an innovative and inexpensive plumber who solved my problem with quick, easy grace. Yet, it wasn't all luck. I was resourceful by checking my options before deciding. Virginia Satir, an innovative family therapist, author, and teacher, recommended to her students and patients that they consider three options before acting on something. She said, "To have one choice is no choice. To have two choices is a dilemma. And to have three choices offers new possibilities. I love to collaborate with others to discover bargains, high value at low cost. Bargain hunting is an opportunity to be agile by considering several approaches to solving a problem and discovering a suitable solution that is both efficient and effective." Are you regularly considering your options? To be more agile, consider at least three options. Airbnb's shipping culture. How long does it take a brand new software engineer at Airbnb to safely deliver new functionality to the company's website? In many companies, the answer would be weeks or months. The general notion is that the work of newbies isn't safe to ship to production, and they need lots of training and mentoring before anyone trusts them to release to production. But at Airbnb, new hires ship within 2 days of being employed. How is that possible? Aren't managers afraid these newbies will screw things up royally, putting their own jobs on the line? Actually, the opposite is the case. Delivering value safely, quickly, and easily is something Airbnb values so much that they've built it directly into their onboarding program. The goal is to help new hires understand that they are trusted to ship to production. Here's how it works. A mentor is paired with a new hire, and the mentor finds a defect to fix or some small feature to build. On the new hire's first day of work, the mentor helps them configure their computer. This is automated, so it doesn't take a lot of work. The mentor next helps the new hire understand their task, and then the mentor gets out of the way. This experience gives every new hire a chance to understand Airbnb's deployment pipeline and the steps necessary to get an idea safely from their fingertips to production and into the hands of real Airbnb customers. If they have any issues, their mentor is there to help. This approach enables agility. Airbnb cares about delivering value continuously and invests in making its deployment pipeline safe so developers are trusted to release value to customers safely, quickly, and easily. Drive out fear to enable agility for everyone, especially new hires. Oprah Winfrey in Texas. On April 16, 1996, Oprah Winfrey's popular TV talk show focused on dangerous foods and included a discussion with experts about mad cow disease, a serious problem in England at the time. One expert from the National Cattlemen's Beef Association assured everyone in the studio and television audience that American beef was safe. Another expert, a fourth-generation cattle rancher turned vegetarian, argued that it was far from safe given the widespread use of animal parts, including ground-up tissues and bones of other cattle, sheep, goats, and pigs, in cattle feed. Alarmed by what she heard, Oprah declared on air that she would never eat another burger again. Those words sent cattle prices plummeting. Leaders of the Texas Cattlemen's Association were furious. Believing that Oprah had lost them millions in revenue, they filed a $12 million lawsuit against the talk show host for violating the False Disparagement of Perishable Foods Products Act, a Texas food libel law passed a year earlier. In late December 1997, a judge ruled that the lawsuit was valid and shocked Oprah's attorneys by announcing that an impartial jury would hear the case in Amarillo, Texas, starting in early February 1998. Oprah's talk show aired from Chicago, and she was bound by a contract to broadcast 200 shows per year. She could not simply put her show on hiatus while fighting the lawsuit in Amarillo. She could settle out of court, but she was convinced she hadn't violated any law. She decided to fight. Suddenly, Oprah had only 4 weeks to move her show and staff to Amarillo. In early January, her staff flew to Texas and found the Amarillo Little Theater. The facility lacked the electrical power needed for the show's production equipment, had inadequate seating, and a stage that was too small. Her team upgraded the electrical power, extended the stage, and improved the seating. Then they gave the show a Texas theme, renaming it Oprah Winfrey in Texas, and giving Oprah a cowboy hat, and booked famous Texans to be guest stars. When the trial began in February, Oprah sat in court all day and then filmed her daily talk show in the evenings. As usual, her graceful performances on the show were enjoyed by millions. 6 weeks later, the jury agreed that Oprah was well within her rights to talk about food safety on her show and voted unanimously in her favor. As she left the courtroom, Oprah declared it a victory for free speech. Don't let an unexpected event derail you. Handle change gracefully by being quick, resourceful, and adaptable. Investing in agility at American Airlines. On a Friday afternoon in early February 2020, not long after the World Health Organization declared COVID-19 a global health emergency, the Trump administration suddenly mandated that all U.S. airlines ask passengers whether they'd visited China before being able to check in for their flight. Every airline had 48 hours to comply. At American Airlines, executives quickly realized that it would be a real struggle to meet the government's deadline. The following Monday, I was at American Airlines co-teaching an Agile workshop in a state-of-the-art training room called The Hangar. During class, Stephen Leist, VP of Customer Technology, explained how the airline complied with the new mandate over the weekend. It's a fine example of agility in the real world. A balanced team of executives, managers, analysts, developers, testers, and others spread across several divisions worked together to update every single American Airlines self-service check-in kiosk and terminal to ask the China travel question. Many of them had rarely worked together. However, for this pressing business, they quickly learned what needed to be done, collaborated effectively, and finished the work in less than 12 hours. This rapid response was possible only because of an investment that the company had previously made. A few years earlier, Maya Liebman, American's CIO, gave IT a new mantra: to be the best at getting better. She and her leadership team inspired all of the organization's software teams to focus on improving four key metrics, described in the book Accelerate, The Science of Lean Software and DevOps, Building and Scaling High-Performance Technology Organizations. Deployment frequency, how often the organization successfully releases to production. Lead time for changes, how long it takes to get a change into production. Mean time to recovery, MTTR, the average time to recover from a failure in production. Change failure rate, the percentage of deployments causing a failure in production. A stated goal for the year was to double deployment frequency and improve at other metrics. Maya and her leadership team did not impose these metrics. They were suggestions. She wrote to everyone in IT, "These metrics aren't meant to pit teams against each other or as a means to be punitive. Rather, they are intended to help you see the progress you're making on your journey. They should be a tool for learning and a validation of your hard work. Don't game the system. There's no need. Instead, as you measure, ask yourself as a team, are we delivering value faster and improving our quality?" The company's airport kiosks had historically been quite challenging to change remotely. To alter what travelers saw on a kiosk, a package of native software had to be built, tested in-house, and then deployed to all kiosks. It could take weeks or sometimes months to deploy anything. The situation was even worse in the case of shared kiosks used by multiple airlines. Changes to those required lengthy approval processes, and outdated operating systems made it hard to support continuous delivery. In short, changing what customers saw on kiosks was slow, expensive, awkward, and time-consuming. It would be a huge issue if and when American Airlines needed to make changes rapidly. Leadership knew this and decided to do something about it. A group within the company was assigned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.